Good afternoon. I'm Harry Cooper, Curator of Modern Art here at the gallery. And it's my pleasure to introduce Joel Shapiro. And I want to thank you for coming and braving the imminent storm and the Marine Corps marathon and everything else that's going on to have, an intimate afternoon with Mr. Shapiro, which is going to be great. And he's happy to take questions, and I think there'll be a real seminar atmosphere. But I will start off by, first of all, telling you that the Diamonstein-Spielvogel Lecture Series provides a forum for distinguished artists to discuss the genesis and evolution of their work in their own words. Dr. Barbaralee Diamonstein-Spielvogel and Ambassador Carl Spielvogel endowed the series in 1997, and they were planning to come, and they couldn't make it. So, because of the East Coast situation. I've known Joel for maybe 15 or 20 years now, and followed his work for longer than that, and I'm sure you've followed his work too. He was born in New York City in 1941, did his college and graduate work at NYU, was at the Peace Corps in India from 1965 to 67, which was important for his developing thoughts about art. And interestingly, at the same time, Martin Puryear was in the Peace Corps roughly the same time in Sierra Leone. Joel has had many honors and exhibitions. I'll just mention a few of them. He was an NEA Visual Arts Fellow in 1975. He won the Skowhegan Medal for Sculpture in 1986. He was a resident at the American Academy in Rome in 1988-89. And in 2005 became a Chevalier, a knight in the French Order of Arts and Letters. He's a member of the American Academy of Arts and Letters and the Swedish Royal Academy. He started showing very early in his career in a very different sort of style with Paula Cooper in 1970, stayed with her for two decades, and is now with Pace Gallery. A brief, very, very selective listing of his solo exhibitions would go as follows. 1976, Museum of Contemporary Art, Chicago. 1977, Albright Knox. 1980, Whitechapel. 1982, Whitney. 1985, Stedelijk. 1987, Hirshhorn. 1990, Louisiana Museum in Denmark. 1995, Walker Art Center. 1997, Addison Art Gallery. 1999, MFA Boston and National Gallery Canada. In 2001, he was on the roof of, well, his sculptures were on the roof of the Met, and I'm sure he was there too. And in 2005, you might have seen his intervention at the Musée d'Orsay, in which he made a sculpture to correspond with a great work by Carpeaux. He has work all over the country, indoors and outdoors, in collections as a result of commissions, including right here at the National Gallery with several pieces, one that is always in our sculpture garden, and a major commission at the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum nearby. I don't think I will attempt to summarize his work, but I think that he's been involved with a great number of the basic dichotomies of sculpture for a long time. Abstraction and figuration, balance and imbalance, surface and volume, color and material, organic and geometric form, inside and outside, which may have something to do with the title today, solid and void, expression and structure, and I'm sure he doesn't think in any of these terms because I'm an academic and he's an artist. So let's yield the floor to Joel Shapiro.
Thank you. Oh, this is, there are more people here. That's good. Well, first thing, I'm so happy everybody came. And I know it's a marathon and there's a huge storm, hopefully not as huge as forecast. And I'd like to thank the National Gallery for inviting me and the Spielvogels for sponsoring the lectureship. They would have been here, but they were ill at ease about the storm. yeah, I chose the title Inside Out only because I think that, you know, what you're looking at when you're looking at work is some aspect of what an artist has thought about and projected out into the real world. And behind that, there's a lot of trial, tribulation, impediments, moments of ecstasy, moments of doubt. It's a complicated process making work. And, you know, it's, so what I wanted to talk about tonight and show you with slides, sort of where my work begins, what I've thought about, you know, what obstacles I encountered, what I think about certain other artists, what they might mean to me. I shouldn't say what I think about them. Well, what they might mean to me in terms of how, as a young artist, you begin to work. You know, it's a big discourse. It's not unlike any other field. I mean, you're sort of aware of what's going on. You're empathic with certain things. And you, can you hear me? Yeah, and you synthesize ideas, evaluate other people's work. Certain work is enigmatic to you, and it becomes more and more interesting. And I think there's a kind of unfolding and recognition as you mature. I actually think most artists get better as they get older. I think when they're young, they might be fresh, shocking, and new, but work can become deeper. So let's start with... the sculpture on the, well, these are two works from the National Gallery, which they so kindly had readily on file because the images I had were cribbed off the internet and were miserable. There's a Carl Andre on the right and Tony Smith's Die on the left. This is work that was going on in the late 1960s. It's sort of when I began to really work and pursue my work. And, you know, Carl Andre was very attractive artist, I think to some extent because the vocabulary was so explicit and understandable. Tony Smith perhaps interested me more because of there was an enigmatic quality to it. Also, it had lots of reference beyond itself. And I don't think the reference was all kind of narcissistic. So these are two, Tony Smith is not considered a minimalist. I mean, I think he has more to do with Barnett Newman and Jackson Pollock in a previous generation. And Frank Stella, I mean, and Carl Andre would definitely be a kind of arch minimalist. His flatness, the work on the floor, and, you know, its sheer materiality. So these are ideas that interested me and that I think I soon tried to abandon. This is a very early drawing from 1969. It's just enamel dripped on paper, clearly involved with Jackson Pollock and with liquidity of paint. And I think my generation were trying to find a new way of working and, of course, referencing the past and trying to develop their own your own vocabulary. This is an installation at a small college in Georgia of kind of crimped and hung baling wire. This is a slide I discovered a few years ago. A fingerprint drawing, this is from 1970. Another fingerprint drawing, this one's in the National Gallery via the Vogel collection. I had no idea that Herb and Dorothy gave this to the National Gallery. And I think at this point, I was trying to find, you know, you, as a young artist, at least I questioned the meaning of the work and what the work meant. And, you know, I was very hesitant to add anything or make any kind of declaration. So I think, you know, in a way, the work was much more involved with my body and this sort of simple extension of self. I'm actually doing an exhibition of this work in New York in the winter. It'll be interesting for me to see it, because I was sort of very hesitant to, you know, I have odd feelings that I destroyed a lot of this work because I felt it was too simple, too direct. And now I look at it, and, you know, it's very diffuse, it's kind of complicated, it's atomized, it has many qualities that I actually desire. So these are kind of stiff photographs of clay, pieces of clay that I was working with at the time, making accumulations of clay, and at a certain point trying to differentiate between when something is really changes from just sheer material to having some kind of other presence, which we would call art. This is a show that I found, this was my second exhibition of the Paula Cooper Gallery. I think the work was okay. I think the processional aspect and the hierarchical aspect of the installation is always embarrassing. I subsequently showed a lot of this work at Andover, what is the name of the museum at Andover? Phillips Academy, but I forget the name of the museum. The Addison, correct, thank you. And it was much more casually installed, and the work was very casually made. When I say casual, it was made in the studio when I had a certain idea and a certain kind of emotional moment. And I think that having to translate that into a gallery is always very difficult. As a museum is the same situation, where they have to somehow translate the artist's intent into the way the work is seen and installed. And I think I was terrified at that point. And was very aware of what was lacking in my work and the kind of great expressive potential of sculpture. And I have two works that interest me, still interest me. Saint Teresa in Ecstasy, which is a Bernini. Anyone who's been to Rome has probably seen it. And the Giacometti woman with the throat cut on the left, which was a Giacometti from the 30s. Which is a kind of synthesis of all the ideas he went through, and I think of extremely radical sculpture, and hard to digest, hard to look at. Now I see it as an object. At one point I saw it as something really spectacular and meaningful and deep and profound, and it's a quality, of course, that I wanted in my own work, a kind of psychologized space. This is a show from 1979 at the Clock Tower in New York. And it was a bridge. I began using imagery. I mean, I had to abandon those kind of hand forms and body forms, and they really had no meaning. I began making pieces that were birds, boats, bridges, trying to find looking for some kind of iconic image that would sum up my psychological state at the time. And I think what was interesting about this work was its small size. I don't think the bridge itself, the bridge is an interesting piece, but I'm not sure if it was on a pedestal, it would be particularly interesting. But that's true with a lot of work. So, I mean, I think the context and its reference, you know, from a private thought into a public space was the kind of challenge of the piece, and then it could indeed evoke more private thought. A small chair, this is maybe a year later or the same time. It's 3 inches tall, and this was shown in a vast space. This was the first show of mine that actually people looked at, I think, because it was extremely small pieces that were intimate and insistent in large public, in a large gallery. It was not necessarily a public space. And I had a show of this work 2 years ago at Paula Cooper Gallery. I was really nervous that this work had no, you know, I thought the work at some point was just about magical thinking and the work wouldn't hold up or sustain itself in the present tense. But it actually did. I mean, it looked good. It looked good to me. So although I've gone way beyond it, it still had a kind of resonant quality. I'm This is an installation at a museum, the States Museum in Baden-Baden. And it was a kind of beautiful, anonymous space. And this was the more intimate, hollow side of the world. I mean, intimate and hollow, you could penetrate. The hollowness, which is an aspect of certain sculpture, can be revealed or not revealed. So there was some serious interest on my part on its revelation, so there was no kind of duplicity in the work. I've since transcended that moral dilemma. I do think it's, you know, work can exist in many, many ways. This is another room in that installation. And I found that after I did this small work and I began to work that in and around this time or perhaps subsequently, you know, that either the work was condensing or it was expanding. And regardless, the limitations that I found, which I was trying to fight against in this, I had done some pieces which I have not included and I should have, that was sort of, they were kind of more architectural. They weren't houses as much as more abstract objects on the floor with flat bottoms and a flat side. And I really began to question, you know, a basic aspect of minimalism, which was that most minimalism accepted the floor or the wall as a kind of reality to begin to where they accepted the floor and wall like a painter would accept a canvas. But even more so, because I mean, a canvas was abstract and this was actually literally in the space. I mean, other than a floor, so the way flatness and architecture inform the nature and development of work is something that really interests me. This is an awful slide of an installation at Pace Gallery. At this point, I was really taking pieces of wood, joining them together, and trying to find a kind of significant psychological state in the joining. There's a piece in the back that begins to break away. I also found that by joining, the very act of joining itself became an impediment because you could only do so much as long as the work parts were anchored together. If one piece joined another piece, joins another piece, joins another piece, you can break that up, twist that around. Also, that combined with the kind of pull of gravity or even work, I would work on a tabletop and then invert the piece, rip the piece apart, twist it around, trying to find a configuration that actually meant something. Exactly why this is here, I don't know. This is a drawing, an earlier drawing on the left and a drawing, say, from the 1981 on the right. I went to the Holocaust Museum yesterday because I had not really been there in years, and I was, you know, I had, again, every time I visit my own work, you have some real trepidation that, you know, it's going to look flat and not vital. But I actually thought this piece was very vital. I don't know, lively is not the right word, and sort of poignant and really meaningful. And perhaps the best example of, you know, sort of where I was joining chunks together, reconfiguring them to find some significant form. Or not significant form, but a form that actually had meaning. In the inverted house, maybe that could have been bigger. Originally, I wanted that house on the wall of the museum, but I was told quite firmly that that was never going to happen, that that would never get through federal fine arts. And then the back piece would have been more forward, but I thought the piece was very successful. I was a little disturbed because the guard came up to me and asked me what the piece was about. I said, well, it was really about a collapsed figure and a kind of resurrection of the figure. He said, oh, he spoke to Holocaust survivors and said it was a broken swastika. So, and it's not that I haven't questioned, you know, the kind of authoritarian nature of form. I once had a show at the Haus der Kunst in Germany, which was Hitler's favorite haunt. In fact, where they had the degenerate art show. And there was a big press conference with, you know, 10 times the amount of people in here. They're all standing around the sculpture. And the sculpture is sort of sticking out of the crowd. I said, Jesus, what do I do? What am I doing? You know, in the meantime, I was sort of critiquing the space with the work. I mean, I had this real sense. And also, of course, that kind of work. So you realize the use of geometry in itself has many negative, can have quite negative associations depending on someone's experience. This is an exhibition in Japan. I have not just used rectangles and squares. The reason I use rectangles and squares is because I think it's the recombination of the form that's significant. You don't invent a form anyway. You create a, you don't find a unique form or unique unit to work with. And also it has this real correspondence in the world. I mean, you could model. The piece in the back is modeled. The piece in the front, which is kind of looks like Big Boy. I mean, it looks like a bomb. I saw it more as a kind of coffin and sarcophagi and the kind of figure on the outside, or male, female. Again, getting away from rectangles. And the actual aspect about using planar work is that planar work really activates and works within hardscape or within a room, within flatness. So you really have a sense of the animation of the sculpture, the animate aspects of the sculpture versus the kind of inanimate aspect of the room. This is a commission in Ottawa at the US consulate. This piece I really struggled with. At one point, the piece was inverted and it looked like Saint Sebastian. I mean, it looked like a figure that was getting lanced. And then in the inversion of the piece, by flipping the piece over, gained this altitude and expansiveness and worked, because if you went to this building, to the right of the figure, there's a staircase that leads down into a lower section of the city. So this piece is kind of floating in front of the embassy. And unfortunately, it's gated off, because this was post Mogadishu, I guess. So the embassy is really super fortified. The glass is 3/4 inch thick. The windowsills are stainless steel. And for the piece to have some life and float. Oh, okay. The piece on the right, I just got this slide. I assume it's a wax from the National Gallery. And the Rodin in the left is a cast of Balzac. I think it's from a park in Belgium. The reason I know that is because I was at a seminar and they had this Rodin and a clean Rodin. There's no question that this one was better. It didn't have a great lifespan since it was so eroded and, you know, defecated on by birds. The reason I bring this up, these two slides, and I hope this doesn't sound too academic, is that I do think there's a paradigm in sculpture between ideas that are projected out and ideas that are kind of constructed from the bottom up. And I think Rodin is somebody who constructs from the bottom up. They're wonderful, they're great. Neither one is better. I mean, I'm not saying one is this, one is that, where Degas really, and it may have to do with, he was terribly blind at the time. They may have to do with memory of figuration, memory of looking, memory of drawing and painting, but the kind of how the work functions independent of gravity in a certain way. I know it has a little stick holding it up. My work may have a bolt, where the Rodin is really anchored in the ground. And I think that this paradigm exists throughout sculpture. I think at the National Gallery, you could see it with David Smith and Alexander Calder. How do you have that license to work that way? I mean, I think it has to do with social values and social structure, and it's a complicated discussion that I know nothing about. But you do have this sense that Degas is somebody who had a kind of imprimatur, as Calder did. You know, and David Smith was much more of a working guy who was going to insist on himself in the physical real world. And I do tend to read a lot of sculpture that way. Oh, there. This is a god-awful Calder, my apologies. And I think that's Q by One installed in a strange installation in Los Angeles where they use scrim to differentiate. This is work of mine from probably 2000, or no, 1999, where I could no longer sort of stand. I could no longer stand adding stuff together, so I was just tossing pieces of wood up in the air, and then my assistant and I would sort of screw in this wooden matrix to hold the piece up. This is another work, perhaps a little earlier, where I was trying to elevate mass into space. I mean, so I'm interested in that kind of lightness and projection versus this sort of heavy buildup from the ground up. Another piece, and I kept looking at this work in my studio. Then I know this sounds cornball, but I had pieces like this, and they were a little stiff. And you know, and also they were flirting with ideas of collapse. And then I kept looking at photographs of 9/11, of the building collapsing. And you know, I began to work with wire and little pieces of wood, sticking them together to find a more natural way of joining, and the kind of, there's a limpness to this work. I think a lot of the wire has given up a bit. The one on the right suspended from the ceiling, both are suspended from the ceiling. The one on the left had a kind of buoyancy, and the one on the right I thought was really poignant and kind of weighty. And I would make them, you know, by taking wire, that wood that was connected, twisting it around, turning it around in all possible directions until I found some configuration that corresponded to my sense of self. These are larger works, again derived. I mean, what I should have in here is the work on the left and the model of the work. And I had to use props. You know, well, I haven't invented. By the way, the other thing, one aspect of sculpture is that I don't think it's a slow discourse. So, not that I think that I'm Carpo, or not that I even love Carpo, but you know, you can find a similar configuration. I mean, the same physical phenomena, you're dealing with the same physical phenomena and the same kind of human condition. It's contextually different and manifests itself differently. But I do think there is a continuum. This is another piece. I should have had the Saint Teresa photograph here. And this was post 9/11. This was the bottom, the one on the left, the bottom sculpture I truly did, I wasn't that happy with. I chopped up a piece of mine and then made this ghostly image of the piece kind of rising above itself. This is a piece, a large sculpture, you know, that really tests the limit of joining. And the problem is once you're not joining, you know, facet to facet, you get into a structural problem where the work begins to collapse. And, you know, to retain, and generally an engineer, if they look at it, you know, say, well, do this, do that. By the time they do this or that, there's nothing left of the piece. There's no sense of moment or lightness. This is a suspended piece. This commission is in London. This started out as like 38 pieces of wood cascading off a building. And then with my consent, I was manipulated to the point where it became a relatively legible figure that was suspended by wire. But I think it was very effective. And it's on the fringe of public space. I call the piece Verge, but no one seems to like that because I think in English it has other references, you know, Middle English. This is the piece, this is a work that I made or chose to make in relationship to the Carpo, the dance. And the dance was, I guess, considered, you know, the end of the old, you know, sort of neoclassical, although it has many modern aspects to it. And if you looked at the Bozzetti, the model of it, you'd really see its kind of movement. I was asked to go to the Orsay and pick any sculpture I wanted and show a work in relationship to it, or they would commission a work in relationship. So I, of course, went there with the idea of Degas. And I said, well, can you bring one downstairs? And they said, no. So that was that. And I had looked at Carpo very carefully and always admired the piece, the movement in the piece. And I was making little pieces like this at the time, small sculpture in my studio like this. And one really, the configuration was basically the same. I mean, it was a kind of swirl of activity around a kind of priapic larger element in the center. So I made the piece and it was successful. I had cut up wood and it was a nightmare to make. This is also large. The one on the left is a model and the one on the right is a larger version. And the other thing, because I have to wrap this up, is that the translation from small to large and the fact that you can do something in your hand, rotate it around, put it together with pin guns, in a very rapid period of time, construct something. You may look at it for 3 or 4 years and not quite know what to do with it or how to place the piece. But then the translation of that into a larger scale is really a trying, difficult aspect of making sculpture. Because you gain a kind of force and you lose intimacy. And there has to be some balance in between. This is extremely complicated. This structure is about 6 foot tall. Extremely complicated. And the joining, when I made the model or made the piece or the study, you know, I put together with pin guns. So it's boom, boom, it's instant. You know, it took a couple of hours. And then you go back and look at it again, work for 10 minutes, rip a piece out, cut a piece off. And then to make the piece larger, you can't use pin guns. You have to use wedges and hinges and all kinds of mechanical devices. Very demanding. Which leads me to more recent work. And this work is sort of planks of color suspended in space, again with a kind of, I think, an emotional basis at its best, at least in this installation, and definitely in the next one. And it eliminates all the issues of base, pedestal, and the mechanics are now wire or are not just string, kind of high density fishing line. It's sort of as strong as steel, but this is an installation at the Ludwig Museum. This is a really challenging installation. It's this colossal space. It's 45-foot ceilings by 45, maybe 50, with this very peculiar staircase in the center. You know, and you really just had to throw chunks of color in the air, but there were very small vignettes within each thing. I mean, I think they were, you could actually pull the piece apart. And like the two yellow and the black, you could leave be. And this big kind of pink piece, which you can't see here, you can't see. And there was this sort of doorway, this red, I called it a doorway. It was very floating and really engaged. It engaged the space, and you know, although it depends on the space for anchoring and organization, I think structurally it's independent of the floor in some way that I find very engaging and liberating. That's a picture of the director, sort of flipping that door around, the door to hell. And this is a more recent installation at Rice University. This one was much more compositional. It was a much more contained, unified space. And I worked like a dog on it. I built it in my studio. And the color may be was more harmonious, more considered. It wasn't as abrupt. And I ended up with a kind of, you can't see it in this photograph. You can see it in here. It was a really small space, so the real activity was along this diagonal. And I think the work, you know, so at this point, the perceiver is joining the work together. I'm not. You know, so as you walk around the piece, it reconfigures and reconfigures, which is what sculpture always has done, but, you know, this much more so. And I think, and I don't think they read as tableaus or, you know, which I hate. There's a lot of installation art I can't stomach. Oh, now we're going to go to my studio now. This is a sculpture that was up in the spring in drawings. This is a piece I'm trying to do larger. The piece is this absolute sense of mourning and loss. And, you know, it's 18 inches tall. I'd like to make it larger. So I'm struggling with that. I've made other studies of it. And, you know, if you can't use solid wood, you don't have the same sense of weight. And that, by the way, this is a piece, I mean, that piece has been around for about 7 or 8 years. And it was only recently that I realized if I created a little angle at the bottom, you know, I could get the center, anyway, that I can get the piece up and be effective. Another piece I'm working on, this I'd like to make large. And another work. A lot of this work has been in the studio forever. And I've been drawing again, which I haven't done for years. This is a recent commission in Denver, at the Denver Art Museum. This is the Clifford, it's actually the Clifford Still Museum on the right, the Denver Art Museum in back. And in front of you would be the Geoponte building, which is really beautiful. And this is a commission for somebody who died. I mean, they wanted me to do it. I met Jennifer once. But she was a city planner who had orchestrated this whole aspect of downtown Denver. And, you know, the piece really works. The piece in its configuration has nothing to do with her. But the actual situation of the piece and the way it integrates the kind of urban complex, I think, really works. So it brings all three museums and these other cultural entities all together. And I think it's being done by color. And the color's really this intense blue that was developed actually by a restorer who worked here and with the Pentagon. And it's paint they use to paint Jeeps. But it's very difficult to get a foundry or a fabricator to use it because it wants to look like a Jeep, very, you know, splotty and bumpy. This is a sculpture that I'm doing for the US consulate in Guangzhou. This has not been installed. That was the model, and it was lively and about this combination of volumes much more than linearity. And that's a model of the facade of the embassy, and that's the work in progress. It's aluminum, and I have to start painting it. That's it.